Good morning. Shabbat shalom to everyone coming in. In other words, happy Sabbath. I pray y'all having a blessed and wonderful Sabbath day. I hope I'm coming in loud and clear. And if that is being the case, today we are going to talk about something that I believe, it is just in general, it's extremely important that we understand what a soul is. You know, the Most High's word keeps it simple, but the world has convoluted something very simplistic. And the reason why the enemy can make something so simple, so complicated, is because he can take the understanding that he instills to others through men and turn it into what he wants us to have. But I'm here to tell you, if we do these things according to the word and its simplicity, it is very clear and easily understood what the Most High is trying to get us to understand. It's not complicated. It's so basically simple. So we're going to find out what a soul is according to the word. Teachings of things like spiritualism and we'll get to spiritualism later on. Understanding what that is the bigger part of the reason why people believe the things they believe, because we've been indoctrinated through too much television, through too many movies, through too many fantasies and all these things. So we miss out in understanding the simple things that the Most High wants us to know. Now, to understand what a soul is, it is a very important factor in being able to understand what death is and what it means and how we are to relate to death. So we must understand what a soul is to be able to understand death. Like I said, the Most High defines, the word defines everything simply, and we complicate it. So we're going to take some of the complication out and give you the simple basics and just grab onto those and go, wow, it's just that easy. It's just that clear. That's just that clear. All we need is an ear to understand the simplicity of the Most High's word. And the only way we get that ear is by studying the word. Matthew 13:9 tells us this. Matthew 13:9 says, "He that have an ear, let him hear." Simply as that. He that have an ear, let him hear. And then Revelation 2:7 adds to it and says this. Revelation 2:7 says, "He that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches." So the Most High's word, that hearing, that understanding is only given to us by the Spirit. So it's a spiritual ear that we must have to be able to receive the truth and simplicity of the Most High's word. So like I said, we're going to keep it simple, and we're going to keep this clear just simply based on the word, not on the adding in or taking away from, simply by scripture. And I hope you have your writing utensil, because I'm going to give you a lot of scriptures, as always, because we have to be involved in the word. The more scripture we study, the more clearly the Most High's word speaks to us. There's a habit of taking one into scripture and then expounding upon those to develop our own understanding. And this is not what the Most High wants us to do. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Study to show thyself approved unto Yah, a workman need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." And the only way we can rightly divide the word of truth is by studying it as much as possible, basically all of it. But we have to study. We have to be in it like we're running out here getting these degrees. We study deeply and hard for those, but we don't study the Most High's word. And this is what will get us to eternity. This is where our salvation is. So we should be way more involved in this. 1 Timothy 4. Go with me to 1 Timothy 4. 1 Timothy 4 and verse 16. 1 Timothy 4 and verse 16 says, "Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee." So we must be in this word. We must be studying this word until when? Until he comes. We must be studying. We must constantly be in his word. He says, read it. be reading. We must be found doing His will, doing His word, whatever it is that He's directing us to do. So we must be in this so that we're not easily deceived. This is a problem. When we don't study the Most High's words, we are easily deceived. And I'll give you a quick example of subtle deception, but it has a major impact. For instance, if I were teaching you something or we were discussing something and someone said, well, how much do you weigh? And I said, oh, I weigh 130 kilograms. And because everything surrounding the conversation or whatever we have seems legitimate and true to you, if I said that, you go, oh, okay. And the truth of the matter is, some of you don't even know how much a kilogram is. A kilogram is 2.2 pounds. But because everything else I tell you surrounding that, you believe or know to be true, you just take those little subtle things that someone else says as truth also. A little bit of poison in the food poisons the whole thing. So if you don't know because you haven't studied, that's more of an emphasis on why you should know. Because the fact that I say, oh, I weigh 120 or 130 kilograms, that's not true. That's a fact. It's more like 88. So we must study so that we know. And if we don't know, we must later on verify, confirm all things by the word. That's what we're taught. Now, I'm going to give you a lesson here. Go with me to Leviticus, Leviticus 10, Leviticus 10. Verses 1 and 2. Leviticus 10, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to show you the importance of understanding and preciseness. Just like with the weight thing, it's important that we're always precise. Leviticus 10, 1 and 2. Now, we're talking about the sons of Aaron. Now, we know they were Levitical priests, and understand that the priests, the things that they did had to be specific and precise. The Most High held them accountable for any slip-ups. And He was so particular, the Most High is so particular still, that it could bring about death. Chapter 10, verse 1 and 2 says, "And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer, and put fire therein, and put incense thereon, and offered strange fire before Elohim, which He commanded them not." So part of the command was, don't bring me any strange fire. So there was a particular fire that they were supposed to bring. Verse 2 says, "And there went out fire from Elohim and devoured them, and they died before Elohim. Then Moses said unto Aaron, This is that Elohim spake, saying, I will be sanctified in them that come nigh me, and before all the people, I will be glorified. And Aaron held his peace." So the Most High says that I will be glorified. You must do according to what I say, or there will be consequences. And Aaron held his peace because he understood, and he understood the direction. He understood the preciseness that was supposed to be held. And he also knew that he had no ground to argue or mourn the loss of his sons in disobedience. So Moses said he held his peace. So it's very vitally important that we do specifically and exactly what the Most High says. So Abihu and Noah and Moses and Aaron and his sons, they all knew the laws and the commandments. We know the laws and the commandments because we have them right here. We know His word because He gives it to us, and He holds us accountable, as we saw with the illustration with Nadab and Abihu. He holds us accountable for knowing what He gives us. He gives us the opportunity. Go with me to Nehemiah. Nehemiah 9, 13 and 14. Nehemiah 9, 13 and 14. We are held accountable. Nehemiah 9, 13 and 14. It reads, speaking of Moses, it said, "Thou camest down also upon Mount Sinai and spakest with them from heaven and gavest them right judgments and true laws, good statutes and commandments, and madest known unto them that thy whole note to them thy holy Sabbath, and commandest them precepts, statutes, and laws by the hand of Moses thy servant. The Most High has given us all this. He has made us aware and known of all his commandments and his law through Moses, through his word. So we have to be very careful in claiming that I don't know, because that's a very popular excuse. I don't know. Proverbs 24:12. Go with me there right quick. Proverbs 24:12 says this. It says, if thou sayest, behold, we knew it not. Doth not he that pondereth the heart consider it? And he that keepeth thy soul, doth not he know it? And shall not he render to every man according to his works? See, the Most High rendered according to Nadab and Abihu their just rewards, because he made known to them, just like he's made these things known to us. So he will hold us accountable. He has rendered the word to us, and he will render our punishment to us if we are disobedient. This is why people go through so many things, sickness, disease, so forth and so on. We cannot say we knew it not. He just clarified in our word that we know it. We can't fool the Most High. There's no fooling him. But it is typical of our sinful human nature to be deceitful. See, we play dumb. We claim we misunderstood, or we just didn't know. We didn't understand that law. If we knew it, we didn't know that rule or regulation. But even man holds us accountable. See, if we can claim that our motives and intentions were pure, even in our ignorance of not knowing certain things. But if the Most High provides it to us, we are held accountable. If we choose to not know it, it's because we're typically not studying. Jeremiah 17 and verse 9 says this about us, and we know it. The heart is deceitful above what? All things. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? We know who knows it. The Most High knows our heart. He knows everything about us. Now, we must choose to know the word of the Most High. And if we are not in his word, we're subject to accepting anything told to us, because we aren't separating ourselves by being in the word, studying the word, as we're told in 2 Timothy. So we must be in this word to separate ourselves from the rest of the world, so we're not accepting anything that any and everyone tells us. So if we have an ear to hear these things, we must lock it in our mind, and we must confirm all things by the word. So here's a simple question. Here is the simple question. What is a soul? This is a very simple question. What is a soul? Now, man's definition says many things. And I'm gonna go through a couple of the definitions, because this is partly where the majority of the confusion is. The majority of the confusion is based on definitions, and it's based on teachings by other men in the world of what a soul is. And everyone, who everyone is, have accepted these things. I'm gonna read a couple of definitions from several different dictionaries, two or three different dictionaries, so we can see the consistency and what the world says a soul is. First definition in dictionary number one, it says, the spiritual or immaterial part of a human being or animal, hold that thought, regarded as immortal. Read it again. It says, the spiritual or immaterial part of a human being or animal. So according to this definition, It has put man on the same playing field as an animal. And this is the part that is considered immortal. Second definition says, emotional or intellectual energy or intensity, especially as revealed in a work of art or an artistic performance. soul, you know, so the interpretation lacks soul, that interpretation lacks soul, that kind of thing. Now, the second dictionary and its definition says the part of a person that some people believe, I'm going to rephrase that, the part of a person that most people believe continues to exist in some form after the body has died. After the body has died. So this definition separates soul from the body. And this is what most people believe. And then it continues, or the part of a person or thing that expresses the basic qualities that make it what it is. Now, it also has several other definitions. It says, if you say someone is the soul of a quality, you mean the person has that quality of a high degree, which is kind of confusing, but they explain it by giving you a statement that says he is the soul of honor. So he is the soul of honor. Now notice it says he is the soul of honor. So it says this individual is the soul of honor. So really what it's doing there is using two nouns to express one thing. Now, couple more definitions, because I really want to get right back to these to the word here, so you can clearly understand according to the word what a soul is. Third dictionary says, first definition says, the immaterial essence, animating principle, or actuating cause of an individual life. Now, just based on that statement alone, how many of you clearly understand what that statement is talking about? You need a dictionary. Most of you will probably need a dictionary to break some of those words down to understand what it's saying. I'm going to read it again. It says the immaterial essence. Sounds deep. The immaterial essence, animating principle, or actuating cause of an individual life. See, these kind of explanations are convoluted and they're complex. And people really don't understand them. People read these things and go, oh, okay. So then with these kind of definitions, and then what man is teaching them and showing them through movies and television and preachings and all these things, people go, oh, okay, I understand what a soul is. So it goes from soul into all sorts of other things like spirits and ghosts, so forth and so on. But I'm gonna stop short of diving into spiritualism, because this is what it's all about. This comes from spiritualism. Now, the Most High makes it so simple and clear, it's all covered in one scripture. Go with me to Genesis 2 and verse 7. Genesis 2 and verse 7. Most of us know it. Genesis 2 and verse 7 reads, it says, and Elohim formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed. Form man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. And man became a living soul. Simple scripture, let me break it down, because most people read it and they read through it. So I'm going to break this simple scripture down. The Most High formed man out of the dust, just like a potter with clay. He formed man out of the dirt. However, he did it by his power. He formed man out of the dirt, out of the dust of the ground, and he breathed into his nostrils. That sounds like CPR. He breathed into man's nostrils. The breath of life. Breath. He breathed breath. Now, let me give you a quick illustration about this kind of thing. We can breathe breath into someone who has lost breath. But the difference is, if they haven't been previously alive, when this sudden need for breath happens, we can't breathe the breath of life per se back into them. But we can restart the life that has already in them if it's not to a point that it can't be revived. But it says the Most High breathed life. He breathed the breath of life into man, and man became a living soul. So in this simplicity, the Most High says this is what a living soul is. Dust of the earth and the breath of life. The breath. So dust and breath, and man became what? A living soul. So understand with exact clarity this. A body without breath is what? A dead soul. A body with breath is a living soul. Very simple and very clear. And you know, with that being said, you can almost say, well, you should get it by now. But because of so many teachings, men would come behind one scripture trying to explain that and unexplain it to the ears of many because you aren't in the Word. Let's go to 1 Peter 3. 1 Peter 3, 20. Now, according to Genesis 2, 7, a soul is dust of the earth and the breath of life, which was breathed into this creation by the Most High. And man became a living soul. Man, living soul. Man, soul. Man is a soul. A soul is a man. If we don't believe me, go with me to 1 Peter 3:20. And I'm going to give you a couple of scriptures to show you some clarity by the word. Because sometimes these words being used interchangeably confuse people. The word soul is one of the big ones. Soul and spirit are very easily misused words to confuse people. 1 Peter 3:20 reads. Now, we're going to start at verse 19. It says, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. Who went into the prison and preached to the spirits? That was Yeshua, right? Or was that Paul? See, when you say spirits, now people get confused. But look at verse 20. It says, which sometimes were disobedient when once the long suffering of Yah waited in the days of Noah while the ark was preparing. So we know this is during the time of Noah. They were building the ark, and Noah preached for all those 100-some-odd years to try and win souls to the Most High. But people kept going by laughing at the Most High. But nonetheless, he continues and says, which sometimes were disobedient, talking about mankind, when once the long suffering of Yah waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls were saved by water. Eight souls were saved by water. Now, if we just shortly remember Genesis 2, 7, it says, man became a living soul. Noah, right here, says eight souls were saved. And we all know those eight souls were Noah and his family, mankind, men and women. Eight souls were saved. So clearly the term soul is being represented in the word as to mean a person. A soul means a person. So as we look to Acts 27, 37, as we go away from Noah. Now remember, 1 Peter 3:20 says eight souls were saved. It didn't say eight spirits or eight entities or eight ghosts or eight anything. It said eight souls were saved. And a soul has already been defined by Genesis 2, 7 as a man. Man became a living soul. A man with the breath of life is a living soul. So the eight souls that were saved during the time of Noah were all obviously living souls, because if there were any, you can't save a dead soul. A dead soul does not have the breath of life. Remember, we made that clarity. A man or a soul without breath is a dead soul. Acts 27, as we move forward, Acts 27. And if you write these scriptures down, you can go over it and you can teach this to others and you can teach yourself to understand it even more. More and more you go through these studies, the more and more you understand it. Acts 27 says this. Acts 27 and verse 37. And we're going to start at 35, verse 35. It says, and when he had thus spoken, he took bread and gave thanks to Yah in presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then were they all of good cheer, and they also took some meat, or they took some food. Verse 37 says, and when we were in all in the ship, 260 souls. So this was when Paul and the group were on the ship, and they come into this rough sea storm, and there was fears. So they went through these things, and the reference is made here that there were 260 souls, 276 men aboard this ship. The word simply and clearly uses soul as a reference to mankind by the very definition of what a soul is. And man became a living soul. Lock this into your understanding, people. A person is a soul. Like I said, when we start getting into spirits and entities and ghosts and all that, that's spiritualism, and that's another study coming your way. But right now, we're clarifying what a soul is because we need to understand this and be able to hold on to it in defiance to anyone trying to get you to believe or understand anything differently. Souls are simply people, simple and clear. A body without breath is what? A dead soul, or a person without breath, a person without any life in them. The breath is that essence. Remember that definition said essence? The breath is that essence that initiates. It's that essence that initiates the life in the body. And only the Most High's breath can initiate life in a body that hasn't had it. We can't do it. We can only give CPR or reinitiate life in a body that has lacked that oxygen or breath because of some tragic situation. And I've given CPR before, and believe me, it works. And we all know it works. So the breath being that essence. Now, speaking of that breath, because the word tells us about this breath at another juncture, this is what goes back, the breath or that essence. Goes back to the Most High because he is the giver, or, and he can also be the taker of that. You know, it's different than our breath, obviously, in his clearer understanding. His breath is different than our breath because it can initiate life. But when we die, that breath goes back to him and the body goes back to the earth. And we're going to get to that in a second. The word in no way teaches or says that it is an entity placed in a body. A soul is not an entity placed into a body. Genesis 2:7, the dust of the ground and the breath of life creates a man. And man became a living soul by virtue of the Most High putting that breath into his creation. Nothing in the word says that the Most High instilled a spirit or entity or any kind of being into the body that he just created. And this is where things start becoming confusing and twisting, especially as far as we look at teachings, because there are teachings that there is a spirit within the body. There is a inner being within this body. And when we die, certain things happen to this spiritual being in us. Now, it brought to mind some thoughts when as I constantly pondered on this thing about spirits. Now, because people will bring up all sorts of things. Now, this teaching, which the world largely teaches, is one aspect of it. But we must also understand that demonic spirits are real. The Most High's word tells us all his angels are spirit beings that he created. We all know this. These are spirits. Now, demonic spirits, or Satan and his fallen angels, they can take over our bodies. This is part of where that confusion of spiritualism comes to place. See, when we're not in the will of the Most High, when we are in sin, demonic spirits can quote unquote possess us, and we can do things that we wouldn't because we've allowed ourselves to be receptive to these things because we're in sin. This is part of the understanding why people think there is a spirit being within us. No, He gives us a whole being by virtue of the dust of the ground and the breath. Spirits can take over us. We never hear of, think about this. Have you ever heard of an angelic spirit of the Most High overtaking someone? We always hear about demonic or wicked spirits overtaking people. People say, oh, I blacked out. I don't remember what happened. But while they had quote unquote blacked out, they slaughtered everyone in their household. And then when these wicked spirits flee, then they go, oh, what happened? See, this is a possession. Now, we're talking about stuff that most people will look at and go, oh, that's foolishness. Well, why do people do things that they don't remember doing? And the things that they typically are doing are negative things. There's nothing edifying and uplifting about the things they do when they can't remember. This is because of spiritual demonic possession. And these things do happen. This is why we must be in the Word also, because when we sleep at rest, if we're in sin, spirits can mess with us. And we all know about sleep paralysis and all these types of things. This is when spirits can attack us. They try to attack us in the flesh and cause things to happen to us, because that's when we're at our most vulnerable. So when we go to sleep at night, we should definitely be surrounded by the Most High. This is why we need to pray, people, and be doing the things that we should be doing. Now, the Most High, Genesis 2:7, I'm going to keep repeating it. I'm going to pound it in the head, just like people like to pound false teachings into your head. I'm going to pound truth into your head. The dust of the earth and the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Go with me to Acts 16, a few pages back to Acts 16. Acts 16, if you're already still in Acts, go with me to Acts 16, verses 16 through 18. I'm going to show you what I just was talking about, spirits. Verse 16 says, and it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain and soothsaying. So this damsel, and she wasn't a damsel in distress. She was a damsel doing the work of the enemy. She was possessed by a demonic spirit, and she brought money to her masters because, see, Satan and his demons, they know things. They're very good predictors based on all sorts of reasons, another study, but they can bring wealth and positive things to those who they're representing. But she was possessed of a demonic spirit. Verse 17 says, then the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High Yah, which show unto us the way of salvation. You know, it's always interesting when you read through the Word, when demonic spirits are speaking through individuals, they always say something about the Most High that's true. So what this demonic spirit was doing was trying to call Paul and Silas out. Those are the Most High teaching that salvation stuff. Get them out of here. See, trying to call them out. But see, in the by the Word, we see some truth in here. And we understand that this woman being possessed by a demon speaking against the Most High, it confirms that she was farther possessed by a demonic spirit. Verse 18 says this, and this did she many days, but Paul being grieved, see, she was grieving Paul. She was grieving the Holy Spirit. She was grieving the Most High. And Paul being grieved turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Yahshua to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. So by the power of Yahshua, he commanded that wicked spirit to come out of this woman. Now it got Paul and Silas in trouble. This is where they were thrown in jail. But it shows us all sorts of things here. See, demonic spirits, they have no power over the Most High. They must yield to the power and commands of the Most High. If he says so, it is done, just like it is with us, or should be with us. But if he commands these spirits to do something, they must do it. So Paul, by the authority and through the power of Yahshua, commanded these spirits out. See, Paul didn't do it of his own power. All right, everyone, I'm back. We had a minor technical difficulty. The enemy's always trying to stir things up a little bit. But we'll pick right up where we left off with the Most High's word. We're talking about Paul, and we're talking about the damsel, and we're talking about the demonic spirits that he had commanded out of her by the power of Yahshua. So, like I was saying, this is something we must understand, that demonic spirits have no power over the command or the power of the Most High. So when they are commanded to do something, they must do it. This is also the reason why we must be in the Word and should be in the Word. And when we see things, wicked things, demonic things going on around us, we should rebuke the enemy. But we have to be sincere, doing it in sincerity and in truth, so that the Most High's word has the desired effect. See, because if we're in sin and we're trying to rebuke the enemy in his name, he's going, I don't know you because you're living in sin, but yet you're trying to use, we're trying to use his power to benefit us. So we must be in sincerity and in truth when we do this. So we must do all we can to come away from sin. So this is what happened with Paul and Silas and the damsel who was grieving them for days on end. Go with me to Mark 5. And I love Mark 5 because we all know this one also. We all have heard about this. We know Mark 5. And we're going to start at verse 1. Mark 5, verse 1. And we're going to touch on this one because we know and we've all heard this. But I'm going to stop at a couple points like I do and emphasize some things, because we can't constantly just read through scripture and go, oh, okay, I get it. No, we don't. We have to study the word. Mark 5, verse 1 says, and they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. So once again, we're quickly being told and exposed to the fact that here's another individual being vexed or possessed by an unclean spirit, being possessed by a demonic spirit or a spirit not of the Most High. So an unclean spirit. Verse 3 says, who had this dwelling among the tombs? And listen to this, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. Now, this is very important to understand, which I'll bring back up to you in another teaching. This part right here says, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. Now, the thing we need to take from verse 3 is that a man, you and I, we can be bound with chains. We can be bound with handcuffs. We can be bound with fetters, and we can't break loose from them. But a man or an individual possessed by a demonic spirit or possessed by a spirit does this, verse 4, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. So if you are possessed by a demonic spirit, we're being shown here that a spirit can break tangible things like chains. This man possessed with a demonic spirit constantly break these chains and fetters. This is important to understand when we get to Revelation 20, where it talks about chains and chains and circumstances and keys and all these things. But anyway, we'll get back to that. And always, day and night, he was in the mountains and in the tombs crying and cutting himself with stones. Verse 5. Verse 6. But when he saw Yahshua afar off, he ran and worshipped him. Who ran and worshipped him? The man or the spirits within the man? The man did. That part of him ran to worship the Most High. Verse 7 says, and cried with a loud voice and said, now here is the demonic spirit speaking, and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Yahshua, thou son of the Most High Yah? I adjure thee by Yah that thou torment me not. So now here is another demonic spirit possessing an individual, saying something, trying to call out, this time trying to call out Yeshua, the Most High himself, trying to call him out. Isn't it interesting? Demonic spirits, when they possess people, because now they have a vehicle. You know, a vehicle is something you get into that moves around. So now a spirit within an individual as that vehicle, now the spirit can speak outright to where the words can be put in here for our edification, for our understanding, for our uplifting. So now this spirit calls out and said, what do you want with me? What don't come over here bothering me. I haven't done, we're not doing anything. But see, they were tormenting this individual. Verse 8 says, for he said unto, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. Now these are the words of Yeshua himself. So Paul, by the word, did the same thing to the damsel in distress. Now the word himself is doing the same thing to an individual possessed by a demonic spirit. And we know his name was Legion because he had many spirits in him, many evil spirits in him. So Yeshua cast these spirits out and they went into the swine. Went into the swine. Let me read them because I want to comment on that. Verse 9, and he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many, spirit. And he besought him much that he would not send him away out of the country. Now, what the spirit was saying is don't banish him off into oblivion. So what did the Most High do? Cast him into the swine. Verse 11 says, Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. And forthwith Yeshua gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. There were about 2,000 and were choked in the sea. The spirits were choked in the sea? No, the swine were choked in the sea. The swine perished. Now understand this. Spiritual beings have to be destroyed, and they can only be destroyed by the power of the Most High. Man has no power over spiritual beings except rebuking them and fending them off through the armor of the Most High. But understand this, as I was saying, now these demonic spirits, they said what they were saying is don't destroy us. So the Most High, he didn't destroy them because it's not time yet. If we read the word, they're held in spiritual darkness until the end of time, and then they will be destroyed with the wicked. Another teaching, another study, but we should all know and understand this. But isn't it ironic that these demonic spirits, about 2,000 of them, they were cast into swine, yet some of us are still eating our swine. See, swine were so unclean, another teaching in that, swine are so unclean that they were worthy of having demonic spirits cast into them. People, come away from this stuff. But yes, some of us eat all the parts of the swine with big smiles on our face. So we're eating something that has been declared by the word so unclean that the Most High will cast demonic spirits into that. Wow. What a teachable moment that is. So Mark 5, once again, shows us about people being possessed with demonic spirits. So these things are real, people. These are very real. And notice this also, in both instances, these spirits were separated from the body. This is part of that false teaching of spiritualism, the spiritualism doctrine. Remember those definitions I read? See, that essence that people keep talking about. They're trying to equate spiritual beings with human beings. They're trying to say that we have a spirit in us that can be separated. By the words, the only spirits that are separated from the body here, and you find it in a few other instances in the word, are demonic spirits who have possessed individuals. We do not have a separate spirit being in us by the design of the Most High. And by our sinfulness, we can allow demonic spiritual beings in us. And they don't stay forever. They stay as long as they stay, and then they flee when it's convenient or when they've accomplished their mission. So here's the question. Okay, these spiritual beings, these demons, were separated from the individuals they possess. Here's a question to further illustrate the point I'm making. Did the body die? No. The body was still fully alive. But see, as the teaching is, when we die, the spirit separates from the body. Well, why would a person have to die when in this instance we see these people are very much alive and these spirits are separated? Because of what I've been showing you. The only spirits that possess us are demonic spirits when they're up to no good and when we allow them to because we are in sin. So that father debunks that notion that there is a spirit in us, because if there was a righteous or good spirit in us, we could separate from that spirit and leave the body be, and it would go on doing its own thing. It would be the same difference. But that's not the case. A person must have the two elements that the Most High has created us with to be alive in the flesh: his breath, and Genesis 2:7, and the breath, the dust of the earth, which he formed us out of. This is what makes a human being. Nothing extra. All the extra is from the enemy. When we're in sin, we allow them wicked beings to possess us. It's the life that he gives us is in, once again, is in that essence of the life he gives us, or it's in that breath. It's not a spirit in there, but there's an essence in this breath that we can't measure. We can't understand. But the word is clear. He's not putting a spirit in us, because if he had, he would say, the word would say, out of the dust of the ground, out of the breath of the Most High, and out of the spirit, he added, and man became a living soul. So understand, like I said, Genesis 2:7, his word is simple and clear. Understand this, people, hang on to it, and don't let anyone deceive you with all these other false teachings. Why would the Most High, think about this question also, why would the Most High put a living spiritual being, like an angel, because that's what spirits are, that we know, the only spirits that we know that he has created are angels. So why would he put one of these spiritual beings in a frail fleshly body? That would be imprisoning a spiritual being into something weaker than it already is. Where is the glorification in his might and power in doing something like that? Now, I'm going to give you a couple notes here. Man is one creation, angels are another creation. We know this. But also add this to your repertoire, to your understanding. Animals are another creation. Think about that for a moment. So forth and so on. Plants are another creation. Water is another. There are several different creations. Man is one. Angels are another. They're spiritual creations, spiritual beings. And animals are another. But remember one of the definitions I read? It says that it's this essence, this spiritual essence instilled in men and animals. No, see, that's a flawed definition. Man is one creation. Animals are another creation. Spirits are another creation by his might, by his power. But we like to group these all together as if they're interchangeable or if they can be combined together. No, man is totally different from animals. This is why when man goes down, this, that, and the other. Now, all animals die the same, but understand that these are separate creations. Now, like I said, we can breathe into others and give them life, but they must have already previously had life, because we can't instill a new life in a body that has never had life. That would be taking, say, for instance, as sad as it is, if we had that ability, we could take a child born in death and breathe life into it of our own. We see it all the time now. When a child is born, stillborn or born dead, they try sometimes to give it life by giving it oxygen. Does it succeed? No. Because the Most High, by His will, let His will be done, by His will, He has not given the initial breath of life to said child. So we can't do anything to change that. It is what it is. And the Most High only knows what His reasoning is behind these things. See, but the devil, he wants us to believe all these things that aren't true. Here's some clarity also. Our breath doesn't change anyone's character or anything about them when we say give them like CPR. We just revive them. No power in our breath. Nothing similar to the Most High at all. So it's at a very simplistic and primary level that we are able to help revive someone. And the devil wants us to think, though, we can live as spiritual beings do. And there's no comparison. One creation and another creation. He wants to think that this spirit in us gets to wander around outside the body once the body dies. Deception. It allows for confusion and false teachings to think that there's a spirit in us that will go on living even after this body dies. You know, this eliminates a whole lot of things like the second coming needing to happen if that were true. But here's another question. Why would any of us, think about this in a very basic level, why would any of us choose to live in these frail bodies if we are aware or were aware that we have a spirit in us that supersedes these bodies? You know, if that were the case, we could avoid sickness and all these things. We could even choose suicide to let these bodies go to waste if we believe that were true. But that is not true, people. This is why things like physical death and suicide are very detrimental. We can't do these things because this is the life and body that we have this life in. And we must do what we are subscribed to do now so that we have eternal life and bodies that will never see corruption. These are temporary vessels, people. When a soul dies, we just simply do what, people? We go back to our original condition. Go with me to Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 7. Ecclesiastes 12:7 reads as such. It says, "Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was," write it down, And the spirit shall return unto Yah who gave it." Now let me stop there because, see, this is part of the false teaching and this is part of the confusion. Now, because verse 7 here says, "And the spirit shall return unto Yah who gave it," does it literally mean a spiritual being? No. I'm going to tell you right now without any explanation. No, it doesn't. Go with me to Job 14:10-14. Job 14:10-14. It reads, it says, "Hast thou not poured out milk and curdled me like cheese? Thou hast clothed me with skin and flesh and has fenced me with bones and sinews. Thou hast granted me life and favor, and thy visitation has preserved my spirit. And these things hast thou hid in thine heart. I know that this is with thee." See, Job makes reference to his total being as spirit. Now, understand, when we talk about spirit, we also understand Galatians. We also understand Galatians 5, which tells us what spirit is. So Job is talking about his overall character and being in itself. So we must be clear about what we're talking about when we speak upon these things. Now, go with me to Genesis 3. Genesis 3, let me make certain here. Genesis 3, 21, and read that right quick. Genesis 3 and 21. Back to Genesis 3, where this study all started. Genesis 3 and verse 21. It says, "Unto Adam also and to his wife did Elohim make coats of skin and clothe them." So he's making this reference here is saying that now this reference from Job 7 that we were just reading, Job 10 verse 7, this is a reference to the spirit. And it takes us all the way back to Genesis 3:21, and it makes reference to Adam and Eve as spirits, as people. So understand sometimes the word spirit can be used to reference an individual. Generally, it's by character is what it's making the reference to as we look at Galatians 5. The spirit, the fruit of the spirit, our character. So this makes a reference to individuals also. But don't be confused, people, because we've already made certain clarity of what a soul is. And we've also made clarity of what spirits are. So we know that this term spirits is not talking about spiritual beings. We've already made clarity about what they are. But sometimes the word spirit can be used to reference individuals. Sister so-and-so is such a humble spirit. See, it didn't say she's a spiritual being. I didn't say she's a spiritual being, but I said Sister so-and-so she's a humble spirit. So what I'm making reference to is her character makes her such a humble person. So understand and don't convolute the simplicity of these words. Psalms 146:4, Psalm 146:4. Go with me to Psalm 146 and verse 4. It reads, it says, and we're expounding upon what happens. It says, his breath, see, reference to the spirit, since it's the Psalm 146 verse 4. It says, his breath goeth forth, he returneth to the earth, in that very day his thoughts perish. So certain clarity is being made here by Psalm 146 4 that his spirit or his breath goeth forth. To eliminate confusion, his breath. Remember, who gave the breath? Did Genesis 2:7 tell us? The breath, dust and the breath. This breath goes forward, it goes back to the Most High who gave it. Very simple, very clear. So what is a spirit in the word? Well, we were just talking about spirit in terms of character. So go to me to Galatians 5. Let's touch on Galatians 5 right quick. Just in case some of you aren't familiar with Galatians 5. So we're going to make certain clarity on Galatians 5 right quick. And we're going to start with verse 19. Two types of spirit, two types of characters, people. Verse 19 reads, "Now the works of the flesh are manifest." So the works of the flesh are manifest. The evil spirit, the evil character are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and the such of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of Yah. So this is the one type of spirit or character when it comes to mankind. See, because these kind of spirits are not, this kind of spirit is not in heaven. All those spirits of this character who were in heaven, we call them Satan and fallen angels or demons. They're all here now with the rest of mankind. And mankind has a mixture of both going on right now. Verse 22 continues and says, "But the fruit of the spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, godliness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Yeshua's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the spirit, let us also walk in the spirit." So we're all walking and living in the spirit that we choose to live and walk in. either the lust of the flesh or the fruit or the fruit of the spirit, the good spirit, love, and all those things. Now, here's the next question. Can a soul die? That's a popular question. Can a soul die? We've clarified that a soul is what, people? Genesis 2:7. We've clarified that a soul is a person. We clarified that by Noah. We clarified that by Paul and the individuals on his ship. And there are many more that clarify this. A soul is a person. Dust of the earth and the breath, simple and clear. Do not allow yourself to be confused by the rest of that, ghosts and all that stuff. We'll talk about that. But can a soul die? This is a popular question. Go with me to Ezekiel 18 and verse 20. Ezekiel 18 and verse 20. We know the soul that sinneth shall die, right? Ezekiel 18 and verse 20 reads, it says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father, neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. So you know what? We all bear our own sins. And if we are a soul that sinneth and we die in that sin, or we get caught in that sin, we die in that sin. The soul that sinneth shall die. So the word is clear. Many scripture tells us that the soul that sins will die. Romans 6:23, a favorite. Romans 6:23, and I'll just turn to it. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of Yah is eternal life through Yeshua Elohim. So the wages of sin is death, and the soul that sinneth, it shall die. A soul can die, and it will die, people. The second resurrection is going to be a pitiful day for those who are caught in it. Now, as we close here, a couple more scriptures and a couple of quick statements. We should fear the Most High in obedience and not man. Do not fear man, because the Most High can raise the body. See, we're not spirits like angels that are surrounded or imprisoned by the weak flesh that can be that type of teaching that can be presented to us. The Most High spirit beings are called angels. His two-pronged creation beings, dirt of the earth and the breath that he gives us, we're called man. And like I said, animals are another creation. The rest of the earth are another creations. They're all types of different creations. Animals are not created. They're not on the same playing field as us. In fact, I don't see in the word where it tells us how animals were created. We know the Most High created them, but the word tells us that man was created by dust and the breath. However the Most High created, that's a mystery for us, and we will find that out one day. But ultimately we know by his breath, by him speaking it, he created all things. He has created all things by his breath, but the word doesn't tell us out of what. We know by his breath all things are created. But it was very specific in saying he the earth was here and all these things. He says, understand, this is how I'm creating you, out of dirt, pure dirt, clean dirt, unfilthy dirt at the time. And out of my breath, this is how I'm going to create you. And we're going to close with this, people. Matthew 10:28. Go with me to Matthew 10 and verse 28. Two scripture here to close. Matthew 10 and verse 28. Verse 28 says, and fear not them which kill the body, the flesh, but are not able to kill the soul. We clarify the Most High is the only one that can destroy a soul, spiritual or otherwise, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. See, don't let that soul and body confuse us. We made clarity. He doesn't mean two separate things about us. We already know what we are. We already know what spiritual beings are. But we are to fear him that can destroy the soul, the person, destroy the body. See, man, think about this. Man can only destroy the body or the flesh of the body. The body, the physical body. But the overall soul, a person, no man can destroy. If a man could kill the soul and body, as we're understanding here, the Most High would not be able to raise us. Because he can destroy the soul and body. Man can only destroy the body. The Most High says that's okay, because that's one of mine. When I come, I will raise that individual anew. You destroyed the body, but the essence, that breath that embodied that individual, I still own that. It sounds complex, it sounds deep, but we need to look at what the Most High tells us in its simple sense. Last scripture, and I'm going to let you go for at least part of the day. 1 Peter 3:14. 1 Peter 3:14. 1 Peter 3:14. 1 Peter 3:14 reads, it says, "But, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake," no matter what man does to us, "but if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify Elohim in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks of you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear." People, don't fear what an individual can do to these bodies, because if we live long enough, these bodies are going to die anyway. We need to die with that righteousness in us, with that hope, knowing that he will raise us again to immortality. These things get tired and old anyway, but praise and thanks to the Most High for giving them to us for as long as he gives them to us. Until our next upload, I love you all. Shabbat shalom. Have a wonderful day. And I pray that I can come back later and give you another study, which will fall in line with this one, which will teach you some more things that you need to know to understand this whole concept about living and dying and souls and spiritualism and so forth. This is Brother Lloyd. Love y'all. Have a blessed and wonderful Sabbath day.